conventional norms, but depicts each character with new insights, and sometimes those insights are surprising. For example, elsewhere he's depicted Jesus as a clown, a harlequin. And if you join us on Maundy Thursday, you'll see that his depiction of the Last Supper includes around the table a Jew, a beggar, a prostitute, an African Gastarbeiter wearing the striped uniform of a concentration camp. Many of his characters are depicted with great love and tenderness, and his range is utterly inclusive. Everyone finds a place at Jesus's table in Koder's world. The full range of humanity, from affluence to lowliness. Koder's kingdom is inclusive and committed to social justice. At times, the figures are warm and humorous. And at times, the figures who represent the crippling institutions are shown as harsh and merciless. I find a real earthiness and grounded humanity in Koder's world. I see myself in many of the characters at different times, the harsh and cruel alongside the tender and lovable. Surely much of the depth of his humanity was drawing on his life experience, particularly in the concentration camps. The message that I find is one of understanding the whole of the human race and finding in each person a moment for redemption and restoration, emanating from the healing love that God offers to us all. The journey we will follow is a series called The Folly of God, A Path to Light. We've used many of the words from the collection itself and some of our own, interspersed with music by Voces 8. Please allow yourself to be totally absorbed by the art, words and music, which will take us on a journey which offers us the full range of colouring of the whole of humanity and a glimpse into the depth and mystery of Christ's life and death. But just a few practical points first. The text is interspersed with pauses. Please don't be disconcerted by them, but use them for reflection. After the seventh station, we will have a 15-minute break. Don't get out of Zoom, just leave it on. There'll be a slide left on screen with music playing until we're ready to start again. And our final station leaves Jesus in the tomb. And after the final reflection on that picture, there won't be a coming back together, but the last slide will be left on with music. So please leave when you're ready to do so. So we're ready to start.
Our first station. Jesus is condemned. They led Jesus off to the house of Caiaphas, the high priest. Pilate took some water, washed his hands, and said, "I am innocent of this man's blood."
Three figures, three worlds on trial. Possessive hands holding the scrolls of the law. Detached, unconnected eyes. Priestly garments. A seemingly harsh will of God that the innocent should die for all. Is this relying on God? Is it not rather an escape? Manipulation in God's name? Washing hands, corrupting with blood the pure water. One day, That water had been changed into wine to gladden the hearts. Now becomes blood of betrayal. Truth? What's the truth behind that masked face, that furtive look? The truth you refuse to see, the power you don't want to lose. The truth? Here is the man. The obedient servant, mute like a lamb, his ear attentive, his back stripped of the regal garments, offered to violent strokes. His face at peace, in the heart a song. Here I am, I come to do your will.
We pray. God of the accused and the accusing, who made the mouth, the ear, and the heart of all in conflict, may we turn ourselves towards that which must be heard, because there we will hear your voice. Our second station. Jesus embraces the cross. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull. It is called in Hebrew, Golgotha.
The naked, heavy wood, embraced tenderly by bleeding, bared hands. Crimson garments soaked with streams of red blood. The wood is steady, firm. On it heavily leans another piece of wood, the cross. In the background, hanging nooses, reminders of violence and war. Indisputable witnesses to generations of innocent victims. Yesterday. Today. Two hands embracing. An unjust verdict. The human sorrow. A destiny shared. A cry hidden behind the cross, the innocent one.
We pray. Lord Jesus, the mystery of your cross is at the heart of our lives. Help us embrace the world as you did. Give us the perseverance we need to make our world a better place. Your kingdom come, your will be done.
Jesus falls for the first time. Crushed because of our guilt, the punishment reconciling us fell on him, and we have been healed by his bruises.
On your knees, under the cry of the world heavily weighing on you, the pillar of the universe. Darkness and horror plunge onto the wood of your cross. The implacable, grim-faced judge. The tormented bodies of the victims of violence and vices. The sin of the world. On your knees, the translucent flesh stained with blood, your right arm firmly strained, unbent, steady like a pillar beam. The right hand firmly planted over the solid stone, supporting, securing. The head leaning on your heart, the source of your strength. Determined as you are to lose none of the little ones entrusted to you, you the cornerstone, you the pillar of the universe, you carry us all.
We pray. Jesus, you bore our sin so that we might live. You are the rock of our strength. Do not allow us to neglect those who are crushed by their own mistakes, those who feel rejected, sinful.
Thank you.
those with positions of power. Or in the one whose head is bowed. His arms are lowered in peace, only being raised when nailed to the cross. Innocent people pay the price of dishonesty, of abuse of power, even by those who act in God's name, indeed by anyone who manipulates the truth of the gospel to justify non-involvement, refusal of the truth. How ready we all are to surrender to hypocrisy and to hide behind the mask of our lack of courage. We would rather not get involved, but distance ourselves from the wrong we see around us. Keep silence in the face of injustice inflicted on our brothers and sisters, friends, colleagues, neighbors, and loved ones. All we want is to keep our name clean and our reputation good. Precious gift. We can create or destroy, lift up or force down. We can embrace or push away. Jesus uses his hands to bless, to gather the lost to his arms, all the time working for peace, until finally he gave his hands up to the cross. Accepting and embracing it, He embraces our sorrows, our cross.
Our fourth station, Jesus meets his mother. His mother kept all these things in her heart.
Two figures, bound together by the vigorous wood, firmly standing between them. Two lives tied as one by the same destiny. Two persons identifiable only, one by the scarlet regal garment, the other by the green clothing. The mourning veil. A mother and child. So intimate. What is the emotion depicted on their faces? What are the words they utter to each other? Do they lean on each other's shoulders? Does the mother caress her child's cheek? Does the child comfort the mother? We know not. Only the hands speak to us. A gentle touch, encouraging, reassuring, affirming. A sacred encounter, an intimate moment, not to be exposed to indiscreet eyes. The only witness, the strong protecting wood held in their embrace. Silent words.
We pray. Lord Jesus, your mother shared your pain, your destiny. As so often we hurt those we love and fail those we hold dear, help us to share in the healing power of your love. Our fifth station. Simon helps Jesus carry the cross. They seized a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the countryside to carry his cross.
Travellers on the same road, under the one same load, body upholding body, shoulder by shoulder, cheek by cheek, twinned as one. Carrying the same weight, they become one. Their eyes fixed in the one direction, they strive onward towards the same goal. There is a need to stay close to one another, synchronizing their pace, gaining strength. The beam on their shoulders is heavy. Any shift in weight, any disharmony will weaken them both. Together as one. Is it by love? Friendship? Solidarity, or simply by chance. Whatever brought them close is irrelevant. Under the same weight, they are as one.
We pray, Lord, as we journey, help us to see those who stagger along the path of the cross, the refugees, the homeless, the lonely. We ask for strong shoulders on which to ease the load of others, and a heart filled with love for all. Our sixth station. Veronica wipes Jesus's face. I tell you solemnly, insofar as you did this to the least of my sisters and brothers, you did it to me.
A gesture of love, and the spotless linen soaked with blood reveals the features of a wounded man, a suffering figure, an enduring face at peace. a woman in mourning robe, her face screened by the linen she holds. Tenderly, compassionately, displays the shroud resting on her chest, imprinted as part of her very being. An empty, cracked bowl, seemingly emerging from the body whose face is fixed on the linen, held up for all to see. Whose hands? We can guess by the colour of the skin. Whose empty cracked bowl?
We pray. Lord, help us to recognize you in the hidden corners of our world, in the forgotten ones, those who mean so little to the world, whose presence is never greeted with a smile. Veronica, your story is doubted, but valuable. You did what you could, even though it was very little. May we do the same, even when we doubt. Our seventh station, Jesus falls again. Anyone who does not carry his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple.
Rough-hewn, heavy beams, hammering, forcing the shoulders of those who carry them. So great the strain, so grotesque the misshapen bodies beneath. The throng emerge as an unseen multitude, beneath the horizon, bathed in the pale light. Different races, peoples, prostrate on their knees, heaving their own load. They have no escape. Someone surges forward, fixing gazing eyes on the one who leads the way. In him, a difference. With his arms clinging the rough wood that bends him down, he seems to have a purpose. He seems to know the sense. On his knees, he draws them all.
We pray. Lord, to pick up our cross and follow you is a difficult request. It may be that in today's world, our responsibilities are our crosses. Whatever the cross, may we understand that only with you the burden is light.
Hard to stand by and see a child, a friend, a loved one struggle with life. Sometimes it is difficult even to say the right thing. Often we don't even know what to say. We would like to spare those we love from the burden of carrying their own cross. Love is utterly vulnerable, completely defenseless, open to whatever comes. To love is to set people free to follow the demands of God, whatever the cost. All we can do is to be there, just being, consoling, supporting, showing respect. These are sacred moments. Where do we see the face of Christ today? In our streets, crowded with people struggling under the weight they carry. Degradation, desperation, hunger, violence, abuse. Do we have the courage to stop? To get involved. Perhaps we would rather keep our distance. Strangers, refugees, are they any concern of ours? Who is my neighbour? Simple acts of love show the power of love. Being beside someone on his or her way to death and mopping their brow is a simple yet love-filled, intimate act, which can only bring us closer to Christ. This is our time for a break, and we'll be starting again in 15 minutes.
Jesus meets the women. Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children.
Mothers weeping, lamenting by the well-worn path, trodden daily by the convicted, being led to death. Injustice manifest before their very eyes, an innocent seized, a horrendous crime. They know him, a firstborn child, nurtured by his mother like a sapling. He lived among them, curing their ills, soothing their pain, embracing their children. Should evil be returned for good? Mothers of the world, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves. Weep for your children. Look at your vulnerable offspring, the children you nurtured in your womb. Can you spare them from the violence of war, from devastation of nuclear attacks, from barbed wire that tortures their flesh? Mothers weeping and lamenting on the roads of the world. Your cry resounds throughout all of history. It is heard in Ramah, in Bethlehem, in Hiroshima, in Auschwitz, in Kosovo, in Rwanda, in Syria, Congo, the Sudan. There is no end to the tears running from your eyes. Mothers on the journey of life, trust the green wood, the innocent son who has strength to carry your sorrow, to give your children hope.
We pray. Jesus, you are the beginning and the end, the one who leads us out of death into life. Help us to be people who nurture, giving life to those who feel abandoned or let down in any way. Our ninth station, Jesus falls again, and the world falls with him. His yoke is on my neck. He has deprived me of my strength.
The weight of the whole world. pressed on the dust of the road, rejected, wasted. The thick timber holding his neck, pinned like a mouse in its trap. Who could ever rise again after such a fall? No one passing by, no weeping women, no consoling friends, no mother's touch to comfort, to reassure, not even the jeering crowd. Crushed and alone, where is God? Mingled with the dust of the earth, held down, exhausted. Under the vastness, the immensity of a pale blue sky. Can anyone ever stand again after such a fall? The one who trusts. Far above the pale blue sky, the sun beams its light, bathing the wood, resting on his face.
We pray. Lord Jesus, when all looks to be too much, when we feel overburdened by life, when nothing makes sense any longer, allow the warmth of your love to touch us. God of the ground, whose body was, like ours, from dust, and who fell, like we fall, to the ground, may we find you on the ground when we fall. Give us the strength to say our amen to God, and to trust in the Father's care. Our tenth station, Jesus is stripped and his garments divided. They took Jesus' clothing and divided it into four shares.
Deprived of its oneness, stained with blood, a seamless white robe, pulled at its four corners, tearing in the middle, forming a cross. Three church leaders, finely attired, claim ownership of the cloth, hold it tightly, even comfortably, misled in their belief, blind to one another, each think he owns the lot. Bloodied and fluttering like a flag, the fourth corner. a black figure marching, striving ahead, eager to reach out. At the foot of the cross, the seamless white robe, each part weakened, divided, spread out, yet held together by the shadow of that same cross.
We pray. Lord, our ways are not peaceful ways. Fill us with your Spirit, that we may truly become your people, the one body of Christ. Heal our divisions and give us courage to work for unity and for peace. Our 11th station, Jesus is nailed to the cross. All who see me jeer at me. They sneer and wag their heads.
The sunlight thickens, colours fade, the sky darkens. Why? What are the people looking at? Or rather, who is looking at them? The man being crucified, lying below. The Roman soldier's arm, clad with armour, brandishing the hammer, relentlessly striking on the nail, penetrating the flesh. A reaction at each heavy blow, each face is different. Compassion, mockery, grief, condolence, sneering, dismay, horror, scorn. Some faces are shielded, unable to bear the sight. Some scrutinize the scriptures in an attempt to make some sense. Wild bulls encircle me, strong bulls surround me. All the while, the sun darkens and the sky grows dim.
we pray. Lord of love and compassion, help us to be true to ourselves and to others. Give us a sensitive heart to ease the burden of those who can't help themselves.
In everyone's life, there are moments of inner loneliness, a rejection no words can describe. It is the isolation of the aged, the loss of a dear one, the collapse of a family's fortune, the horror of war, the loss of a job, the breaking of a relationship, dreams not coming true. Weighed down by the awfulness of it all, we feel crushed and defeated. Jesus experienced this emptiness on his very flesh. He drank the chalice to the very dregs, still trusting in the Father's unfailing love. There are moments in each one's life when we feel as though we are nailed, as if to a cross, unable to move, totally at the mercy of others. It may be because of sickness, disability, fear, violence, physical or psychological hurts. When we feel helpless, we come face to face with our own truth and the truth of those around us. We can become victims of others, or we may make others pay the price of our indifference, of our insensitivity. As we look at the faces of those around Jesus as he's being nailed to the cross, can we see ourselves?
Our 12th station, Jesus dies on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me?
Tortured, bleeding, racked by pain, and so stretched that his bones can be counted. Thick ropes securing the body to its torments. The head cast towards the darkness. The mouth releasing a loud scream against the sky. The ancient cry, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, will no longer be read. It is now heard in the violent scream that rips apart the sacred scroll, tearing the curtains of the temple from top to bottom. It is accomplished. The ancient covenant giving way to the new one in his blood. The crowds, appalled, turning away from him, so disfigured did he look, seemingly no longer human. Without beauty, without majesty, a thing despised, rejected by people, struck by God. Who can bear this sight? Who has the strength to stand by? A mother, a friend, a disciple.
As scripture says, you didn't accept sacrifices and holocausts. You gave me a body. Here is the body of Christ, the innocent victim who takes upon himself the human sorrow. Jesus dying on the cross, his whole being stretched to the limits of human bearing. His tortured body recalls the torments of millions of men, women and children throughout the world, past and present victims of racism, hatred, and war.
Lord, from heaven, the news and
Our 13th station. Jesus in his mother's arms. Peace be with you. My own peace I give you. A peace which the world cannot give. This is my gift to you.
All is fulfilled. Now there are no cries of sorrow, no pain, no struggle. A corpse finally at peace, secure in his mother's embrace. Silence, intimacy, peace. A mother tenderly enfolding the child of her womb, cherishing his blood-stained body, naked as the day she gave him birth. Now she hushes him into the dawn of a new birth. The skulls of our forebearers, a symbol of death, now superseded by the new creation. A new dawn filtering through new life. The dove, bearing an olive branch, announces the new covenant of peace. His gift to all.
We pray. Lord of life, we pray with Mary. Give us faith to love when our hearts feel cold. Give us hope when all seems lost, and trust when we feel bereft. In Jesus, may we find the source of our new life and our peace. Our final station. Jesus is laid in the tomb. Unless the grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains a single grain. If it dies, it yields a rich harvest.
The burial cloth, translucent, revealing a body at rest, the face at peace, wounded hands marked with red blood. Inside, the tomb is dark and spacious. Outside, the promise of a bright, warm morning. The light is breaking through the stone which seals the entrance. Within the linen cloths, the body dazzles like a pearl into the oyster shell, a chrysalis into its cocoon, a seed in germination, an embryo in the womb. The inexplicable, untouchable, invisible, recreating energy into the soil swollen with new life.
We heal the failures of our hopes, our dreams, our plans. Our efforts may appear empty and our attempts fruitless. The stone is rolled against the door of our hearts, on our relationships, our whole life. The stone shuts everything out. Yet, unless the grain of wheat dies, it bears no fruit. Baptized in Christ, rooted in him, we are bearers of his new life. We carry God's reassurance that with him, nothing is impossible.
We pray. Jesus of the unexpected, for at least some of your life, this was not how you imagined its end. Yet, even at the end, you kept steady in your conviction. Help us to believe, Lord, that ends are but beginnings, and that graves are but the doorway to a new life. For you are the Lord of the living and of the dead.
Friends, strangers, mourners, grieving for the loss of hope in the world. We are together because we seek to understand a fraction of what has just happened. We are together because we want to be alongside all those who die on a cross. And we keep silence. We keep silence because words fail us. We keep silence as Christ kept silence on the cross. We keep silence with all those being crucified today, with those who live in darkness, in pain, in despair. We keep silence for those who are sinful in our society today. People who seem different on the fringes of our society. We keep silence with those who have been robbed of a sense of dignity, who have been abused, violated. We keep silence with all those who mourn someone they have loved, especially during these pandemic days. Silence with those known to us today who live in darkness and find it hard to see beyond death, desolation, despair. Amidst pain, oppression, suffering, and death, God is silent. God is silent on the cross in the crucified. And this silence is God's word, God's cry. In solidarity, God speaks the language of love. God of life and death, we wait in hope. God of all the worlds that are, we wait in hope. God of dazzling darkness, wait in hope.